Namaste. Human beings have a strange fascination for stories. In very ancient societies, you know, attending storytelling occasions or paid films, and by just films, even books, you know, we say books are our best friends. And somehow we always have loved this hearing to stories and learning more stories. And to discuss this interesting aspect of human life, from a psychoanalytic standpoint, we have with us psychoanalysis consultant, Mr. Himanshu Vaidya. Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
So, sir, can we go into the significance of stories for human beings?
Human beings are hardwired for stories. In fact, we don't realize the significance of story in the psychic life of human beings. If you look at the entire world of stories, we have the whole world of stories comprising of stories from history, stories from mythology, stories from films, stories from literature, stories told by storytellers, professional storytellers, which are still existing in India and many parts of the world. In shamanic traditions also, the shamans used to often tell stories. Then we had saints and sages in India who would roam around spreading spirituality, and they would have their own stock of stories to tell. Then you have the grandmother telling stories, the elders and the parents and the neighbors telling stories, teachers telling stories, people going out of their way to see television serials or films, and they get so involved in the stories that they start feeling sad or feeling happy if certain things happens in the story. The identification is so strong. And many people can't make do without seeing the next episode. And we all hear people saying, don't tell me the full story, I want to see the film. The unfolding of the story is so relishing to us, so delicious to us, that for some psychological reason, one of our characteristics as a species is we have a special place for story in our life, and also a special place for storytellers in our life. Unfortunately, in the last 25-30 years, there has been a demythologization of human life. And with that process, which has at the foundation the difficult part of modernity, which is assassinating the myths and the stories. So this story assassination in general in human life has been on for the last 20-25 years, and we see it is not a very wholesome state to be in when we don't have stories in our life. And the moment we listen to stories without holding back any part of ourselves, we feel so happy, so wholesome, our feet are touching the ground. And we get the feeling of being grounded, organic, and somehow attached back to nature. So stories have a very special place in human life. We even create stories. For example, just take example of some soldier who has died fighting on the front. And in his village, if you visit, 5 years, 10 years after he has died, people would have created mythological stories around him. So this is something which is very natural. We love to exaggerate. We love to dramatize. We love the surreal. We love to put in imagination and create surreal stories out of everything, as though the surreal story itself was one of our staple foods. And there are a variety of reasons why nature has made us so, why we are so crazy after stories, and why a good story is such a deep need for human beings. So story is not only for entertainment, it is also for learning, it's also for catharsis. It's also for transmission of wisdom from one generation to another. So a story is not only entertainment, it is also education of the real world. It is rehearsal and threat preparation of what's going to happen. It is a preparing for the real world. It is related to our archetypal development as we enter from one stage of our development to the next. So there are stories appropriate to each of the stages of our life. There are stories which are appropriate to pass on transmission of wisdom from one generation to the other. There are stories for entertainment. There are stories for catharsis. There are stories for containing secret wisdom. There are stories for carrying on the tradition through mythology. And there are stories in mythology which express our deepest unconscious desires and fears. So the story of the story is that there is a world of stories, and each story has its own purpose, its own nature. And hearing the story, processing the story, and the significance therefore of the storyteller who can tell us the right story at the right time and help us in our well-being and development and help us address our deepest of needs. The significance therefore is of the right story and the right storyteller, one of the very important elements in human life. Unfortunately, we have not recognized the criticality of the story and the storyteller. And that is something which is deeply missing from our life, and we are paying a price for that.
So did I hear you say story for learning? Can you elaborate? Or can we go a little deeper into it?
Yeah. Let us say story of Mahabharata. There is a world of wisdom in that story. Not only in Bhagavad Gita, which of course is one of the richest learning elements of the whole story, but let us say the killing of Abhimanyu. There is a lot to be learned from there. If you look at what happens after the Lakshagra, there is a lot to be learned from there. But because we did not learn from there, we repeat the mistakes. So Prithviraj Chauhan, thousands of years after Mahabharata, did the same mistake which the Pandavas did after the Lakshagra. Even when they knew that there was an attempt on their life, they did not fight and kill the Kauravas, or they did not pay back in the same coin and do the same cunning to Kauravas. And you see Prithviraj Chauhan again, thousands of years later, he did not kill Ghaznavi. But when Ghaznavi got the charge, he never left him. So there are stories. Take a more practical example. Very often, mothers or fathers who are working, they come back from the office and tell their children what happened during the day. And this for the child is very educative, because he knows what all is happening in the office. The entire office scene gets into the mind of the child. So when that child goes into the office, when he grows up, it's a very familiar place. Compare this with a child who never heard stories of the office. For him, everything is new, but the other person is already well prepared. He has already absorbed, analyzed, processed the whole scene of the office. So these stories are stories of learning. Similarly, there are stories of wisdom, stories of saints, stories of Gautam Buddha. They are stories of wisdom, where you can extract the sap of experience from them.
Sir, of course, Ramayana and Mahabharata have immense impact on our minds. And these stories are special, but how special, I mean, how super special are they, or how important are they, if you can throw some light on that?
Let me just put two statements for the last question and then come back again to Ramayana and Mahabharata. If we go into the way the mind works, it is very important for the mind to get data from outside. In early childhood, the whole system is raring to go. And it requires data from outside, what to process. But the learning potential is the highest. The thinking speed is very high. The learning capacity is very high. And therefore, at that time, the mind is like an open software. The nature has not made us with detailed knowledge. Nature has made us with capacity to get knowledge. So you can see many birds, they can weave very intricate nests, but they can do only that thing, not something else. Their knowledge is completely hardwired. It is embedded knowledge. But in our case, we get an open system and a blank system, and whatever situation we are placed in, we take data from that and we use our basic blank system to process that data, which allows us to stand on the shoulders of past generations and not repeat what the past generation did. At the same time, adapt better to the outside situation, because human beings change the outside situation very fast compared to other species. And therefore, nature has given us this kind of a situation where we have an open software and a blank kind of a CD-ROM. And when this is the situation, stories become that data which the mind wants. Mind wants all kinds of data, but one of the most precious data that can go in early childhood are good stories. So a lot of good data can go in. One element of good data is good stories. Second is, story is also a medium of transmitting learning from one generation to another, a transgenerational learning passover. That's also a very important aspect of the story, that the story preserves wisdom of one generation for the other, experience of one generation for the other. Then we have the mythological aspect of the story, where the learning is of esoteric, occult, and very deep truths of our human mind. Then we have stories like Shakespeare's stories, from where we can learn a lot about the real world. We may not be able to experience everything in the real world. We may not be physically present where all events are happening, but we can hear stories about events and learn from them even without being present there. So it's a kind of a remote learning. It's a kind of a converged learning without participation. And that is what stories are so valuable about. And then we have Ramayana and Mahabharata. And then we have motivational stories. Coming to Ramayana and Mahabharata, in India, they are very important. They are very important for a variety of reasons. One, the value of story itself is priceless. I mean, as works of stories, the stories in themselves are unsurpassable. And they are unsurpassable because all the ingredients of a good story are in those stories. Second, this is a part of our history. These are not just stories, these are historical accounts. And because it is a part of our history, when these events happened, a large part of our society was involved in those events. Either directly or it was concerned about what is happening there. And because of that, the emotional effect of these stories on our society was very large. It was a situation where 75-80% of society was heavily impacted emotionally by what is happening there. So this then passed on generation after generation. And every generation made some additions and deletions to account for their own experiences and make that story relevant to their time. So there is a core story of Ramayana and Mahabharata, and there is a retelling of those stories which is contextualized to keep those stories alive. And because of this retelling, the stories always remain relevant regardless of changes in the world. So the third element about it is all the characters in the stories and events in the stories are very much characters of this world. We don't look at them as fairy tale characters. They are extraordinary characters, but not fairy tale characters. There is a difference. So we find the worst and the best, the ordinary and the extraordinary. And the sheer scale of events and the sheer scale of human determination and what is possible, both on the positive side and on the negative side. And there is a huge amount of emotion, which makes it a very good story to get emotionally involved in and go into catharsis, what the Greeks used to say. Greeks used to say during the best part of the Greek civilization that a story and theater essentially are places of catharsis. And this cathartic element is very high in both Ramayana and Mahabharata. And the sheer events, the plot, the learning, the factuality of it, and very importantly, we associate two avatars with the story of Ramayana and Mahabharata. All of this makes it very important for the Indian psyche, and the way Indian mind is created, quite a bit of that has to do with the fact that these stories were told to us very early in our childhood. So apart from many other factors, they also have a part to play in the way our minds are constructed. Even today, after so many years, these stories still occupy the central place in the cultural universe of this country. And there is still an ocean of wisdom to be extracted from those stories. And therefore, apart from many other stories, these stories have a very special place in the Hindu civilization.
Sir, even mythological stories, I mean mythology stories, you know, they're quite different, but I'm sure they're extraordinary. So how do they, what role they play in shaping our psyche?
So just as you said, there are different types of stories. Stories of history, stories of society, stories of humor, stories of romance, stories of catharsis and tragedy, and similarly mythological stories. So mythological stories are a special type of stories. These stories have a very long shelf life. In the world of mythology, there is something called survival of the fittest. So all the mythological stories that you listen to are not what you pass on to the next generation. Some of them you pass on, some of them you don't. So there is a survival of the fittest of the mythological stories in that mythological realm itself. And these stories that have survived centuries have successfully passed through that survival of the fittest. So these are very special type of stories. One, their shelf life is very long. Two, they have passed through the survival of the fittest test for centuries. Three, they address some of the deepest desires and fears in our minds. These stories almost are like social dreams of the society in a socially acceptable language. They are surreal. They are full of imagination. They are full of speculation. But in that surreal imagination and speculation, there is at the center a very deep core of our deepest desires and fears. And this is the way that the society expresses its deepest desires and fears and puts it out there for social discussion to manage those desires and fears better. And therefore, these mythological stories are very special kind of stories. Third, some of the mythological stories are actually stories where philosophy is codified in a story. For example, stories about creation of this world, stories about end of this world, the story of Genesis, the story of Armageddon. These are stories where philosophy is codified in an entertaining way in the form of a story. And there are stories, mythological stories, which have scientific truths at the center. Even medical truths, that there is a mythological story which says on this particular month you should eat XYZ because of a particular story. That in heaven and hell this happened and therefore this happened on earth, and then people started eating XYZ in a particular month. Now that is a mythological story with medical truth in the center. That because of Ayurveda, they want people to eat certain things in certain days, certain months, and they channelize that through a story. And then there are mythological stories which have occult science, which is hidden in those stories. Those who are able to extract it can extract it. So the story has many layers. On the surface, there is a story. And in the hidden part of the story, there is another account which holds occult truths into itself. So often people talk about the outer Ramayana and the inner Ramayana, the outer Mahabharata and the inner Mahabharata, where there is an esoteric version, the inner esoteric version of an outer story. And when the historical story was converted into an inner story, certain changes were to be made. And that happened in the retelling. So there are various types of mythological stories, each with a purpose and a nature and flavor, but all of them very important and very valuable from our own psychological development and quality of life standpoint.
So this is of course about story. And how about the storyteller? How important, I mean, what role does a storyteller play?
Storyteller is extremely important as a person in our life. Unfortunately, we have given up the significance attached to a storyteller. If we observe children, they will naturally gravitate towards any good storyteller. Often it would be the grandmother, parents, or if there is a society, and in the society, let us say parents of child X are good storytellers, all the children naturally will gravitate towards that particular storyteller. So children have a natural inclination to gravitate towards any good storyteller. If a good storyteller is not available, they will look forward to some senior person, maybe a friend of theirs, but slightly older to them. And within them, one of them will take up the role of the storyteller. So the role of the storyteller is central and archetypal. We are hardwired to find the storyteller in the world. And we all find the storyteller in different ways. And we also create stories and become storytellers ourselves in various groups. So we love listening to stories. We love creating stories. And we love storytellers and we love becoming a storyteller. I can remember in my own childhood, there used to be a person who used to tell stories. His name was Hiralal. He was not very educated, but he had heard many stories from the tradition. And he was about 10 years elder to us. And he would tell stories and all of us would flock to him and in fact cajole him to tell us a story. So we would ask him to tell a story and he would take us to some place where we were not disturbed by others, and a crowd of children would be there and he would tell a story. So I think it's a very natural, hardwired, archetypal behavior that we have. And the high significance of story and the storyteller, particularly storyteller, in ancient societies, people had a special place for the storyteller. It was a profession. So professional storytellers, the bards, they were there in all ancient societies. Over a period of time, that function and that role, unfortunately, has been wiped off.
Sir, is it that the story, not only an authority figure, but something with whom you regard as an authority figure, if story comes from them, it is more valuable a story?
Yes.
Not for just for a child, but even for an adult.
That is true. The storyteller's own credentials are very important. If there is no storyteller, children make it up by one of them becoming the storyteller. But the significance of that story is not high. But if it is told by their parents, the significance is very high. If told by the teacher, the significance is very high. If told by the spiritual person or the shaman, the significance is still higher. So across our life, the significance of the story depends to some extent on the credibility and the significance of the storyteller in our life. And it is true that we respond to stories differently based upon who tells the story. And there comes the significance of the storyteller.
Is it true even for Ramayana and Mahabharata? Being a spiritual text, it is more accepted.
Yeah, these two stories have a different kind of stature. In the sense that the significance of them is not so much derived from the storyteller. But in case of more ordinary stories, the significance of the story depends to a great deal on the storyteller.
We can then lack of it.
Sorry. We can actually differentiate here between ordinary stories and epic stories. In epic stories, they stand by themselves. But in ordinary stories, much of what they are derives also from who tells it and tells it in what way.
Lack of a storyteller must be a serious object loss in that case, right?
Yes, yes. It is. In fact, this is an object loss which very few of us even recognize is an object loss. And because we don't even recognize, there is no question of mourning. But if we go deep enough in ourselves, we realize that in childhood, we had a very clear feeling of object loss if a storyteller was taken away. It was not only the person was taken away, but the person being the storyteller was taken away. So the object loss of a storyteller, object loss of those stories and that experience of hearing the story, these losses we don't usually recognize and mourn. And therefore they remain unattended inside of us unless we go deep enough and find them. I still recollect the person I was mentioning a few moments ago, Hiralal, when he went away from where we used to live, all of us felt very deeply about his loss. We very painfully missed those stories and the experience of hearing that stories. So it was much later when I went deep into myself that I realized that this is an unmourned loss yet to be mourned. And therefore, it's very important for parents also to be good storytellers, teachers also to be good storytellers. And those that we have lost, we recognize the loss and mourn over. Unfortunately, we don't give that significance to the story and the storyteller of early childhood. But if we go deep enough, we realize they have an important role to play in the way we have got shaped up.
And in that case, today's nuclear families, how do children of nuclear family compensate the lack, the vacuum that is created with no storyteller?
They are able to do part compensation. by going to internet, YouTube, computer games, video games, going to comics, going to online comics, going into television serials which are based upon stories. So they try to replace the human storyteller with alternative means, but it fully cannot be done. And therefore, part of the replacement is not done and the loss is there. The experiences and the psychological gains which were to be had by listening to a story from a real human storyteller and then asking him 10 questions and learning in the way. That kind of experience is not there, and people do pay for that loss in terms of learning, in terms of self-development, in terms of development of very many qualities. So there is a loss. They are not able to fully substitute, but they try to substitute the human storyteller by a virtual storyteller, or by reading, or by watching something, or by playing games.
Is corporate the new storyteller, sir, by replacing the sage?
True.
Or the...
In ancient times, it was a sage and the professional storyteller who were the real storytellers in the society. Today, those things are completely annihilated, and the corporates, in their corporate communication advertisements, they are the storytellers. Unfortunately, the stories they tell are only for their own profits. And usually they cater either to the politically correct head of the times or to the lowest common denominator in the people. So these corporate stories which come to us in the form of advertisement and corporate communication, they are not stories of very good quality. They are very utilitarian, mean, and towards making money kind of stories. They would not pass the test of quality if you right. put them to compare them with other stories of ancient times. So that's a very unfortunate situation, that corporate communication is not regulated enough. There is no counter to corporate communication, and the whole mythological dream archetypal space, the entire mythological space, archetypal space, dream space, the surreal, is left open to corporates, advertising industry, and the movie industry. To some extent, television and computer game industry. But this industrialization of story is a story by itself and a very sad story into itself.
Sir, I think, but it has only come into play because there is a vacuum that is created. Right, with no proper storyteller around. So, sir, how does psychoanalysis explain the story of a story, a story, and of course a storyteller?
Psychoanalysis, we try to understand in psychoanalysis, but we don't really understand completely the real deep part of it. But what we understand definitely is Hello? Yeah, you were saying something? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, now I can hear you. Maybe my video I should off. You're not audible. You weren't audible in between.
Okay. So, we look at story in psychoanalysis. One, it is for gratification, by identification. Second, it is managing your anxiety by identification and participating in them. Third, as a threat rehearsal. And fourth, as preparation for the real world to satisfy your desires. So, this is the way we look at the story in psychoanalysis. But Another important element there is the storyteller is like the good parent. He is a part of that perfect, omnipotent good parent. He is also an archetypal figure, the storyteller.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we look at the storyteller not only as an archetypal figure, as a good parent figure, but also as a teaching figure. He is also simultaneously a teacher and a mentor in a very indirect way. And from the human mind perspective, we are looking forward to the process of gratification, identification, threat rehearsal, anxiety management by repeated encounter. And we are looking at very surreal articulation and satisfaction of our desires, and at times satisfaction of our narcissism by identifying with characters which are out of this world. So that is how we look at the surreal as we look at the story as a wish fulfillment zone, as a healing zone, as a cathartic zone, as a zone where we can live out by identification. And the storyteller essentially as a good parent or an archetypal storyteller for which in a way we seem to be hardwired.
Sir, in spirituality also, story and a storyteller has a role to play?
Yes, in spirituality also the story and the storyteller both have a role to play. But before that, let me just say a few statements on how we use the story in psychoanalysis for healing. And in psychoanalysis, the way we use the story and the storyteller concepts for healing are this. One, some people believe we are replacing an old traumatic story by a new story, a good story. And that is the way we are healing. Second, some people believe we are making an unconscious story conscious, and by integration we are healing. Third, some people believe it is by identification and catharsis in the story that we are healing. Fourth, it is by using active imagination and developing the story that the real articulation of the unconscious happens and integration happens. If we complete the story, we give the person a closure where there was no closure. Sixth, when the story itself was only tragic in the past, we offer a mourning so that the story can actually be at least be effectively closed. If not in the cognitive or real life sense, it can be closed. And seventh, it is by creating a good story for oneself and one's future, which can provide us good goals to work towards. So these are some of the seven ways which we use in psychoanalysis, and in all probability we use a mixture of them in a variety of situations for healing. Coming to the question that you had asked about spirituality. In spirituality, the stories are of different types. Stories which are told for self-knowing and self-transformation relate to, one, stories which are mythological and religious in nature. Two, those which have the occult center in them, occult knowledge. Three, stories which are healing. Four, stories which are told in tradition and must be known as a part of the tradition. And fifth, stories which pertain to self-knowing and self-transformation, the spiritual process itself. The storyteller in spirituality often is the guru or the elder disciple. Or some, in religious occasion, some storytellers, in India they can call it the kathakar. There is a special category of profession, the kathakar. They come and narrate the story in a particular way. So both stories and storytellers are very important in the spiritual process, and they are used based upon what is the spiritual path and discipline of the person you are referring to. Based on that, story and the storyteller is selected and stories are given at particular points in time. So it's a very detailed and synchronized effort, which stories to use, how to use, which storyteller to use, and how to deliver the stories, and what effect to expect out of those stories told.
Right. Sir, once again, yeah. How can we develop this area of story and storyteller for healing and even self-development?
First, we have to recognize the significance of story and the storyteller. Once we do that, then we go into detailed development of the area. For example, let us say we have very well-known established pathological stations, let us say the split being open, the Oedipus being unresolved, the healthy self not being created. Can we have stories for each of these particular difficulties, which are difficulties for most people in this world? And can we use those stories, right, to be told, right, to be narrated, to be even lived out in psychodrama if need be? Or if emotional expression therapy of any experiential type, use those stories to work out the emotions. Second way of looking at it is, can we create stories for each of the seven central affects or phenomena which are at the root of most of our problems, say anger, fear, pain, guilt, shame, envy, inferiority? Can we have 10 stories for anger, 10 for fear, and so on? Can we have positive stories to help us strengthen our ego and overcome the disintegration inside and move forward in life with confidence? In fact, there was a very good book, Stories for Healing, something of that sort. I don't recollect the name, but some person had created a book where stories with the purpose of self-acceptance, self-kindness, self-gentleness, catharsis and healing, those stories were put there. So stories for psychotherapy is a very large area, and in that area we can have stories for problems related to each affect, stories for problems related to each of the important psychoanalytic phenomena, and stories for all difficulties we find on the way, and to enhance the positive part of ourselves and enhance our quality of life. So there is a story for every purpose. We are yet to develop fully the story of this story.
As a child, I remember, sir, in our school, we had this subject called moral science. It was an optional subject, but I really loved that subject. And we were taught this subject till class 5, and after that, we did not have this as a subject. Neither have I seen it in any other school that my daughter studied at.
Right.
But I think typical convent schools, they have this moral science karke subject, and which was really nice. You know, it helps you a lot in shaping you as a person.
And the stories of early childhood, they haunt us even as adults. Even today, yes. I recollect the story of Rip Van Winkle. I recollect the story of Snow White. I recollect the stories of Hardy Boys. Even after so many years, not being in touch with them, these stories still have a haunting effect on you. They stay with you, very potent and full of emotions, even after years. So there is something very critical from a psychological standpoint about the story.
Yes. And sir, I always thought, as we were talking, that how important is it from hearing a story from the person who's wrote the story, or hearing one's experience, and, you know, hearing from another person, right, who's narrating someone else's experience. So what is the difference in that? Definitely, the emotions of a storyteller
For example, if you look at Murari Bapu, he tells the same Ramayana as everyone else does. but his involvement and the way of saying it is different. So because the narration is different, the same story is told in a different way, people go to hear him. And that's the power, the moving power of the story. Robert Swoboda writes a very good statement. He says, there are actual truths and there are emotional truths. And the story generally addresses the emotional truth, where for one moment, man leaves apart all his pretenses and cries from the fullness of his heart.
Thank you so much, sir, for another enriching talk.
Thank you.
It is always a pleasure talking to you. Thank you. Namaste.
Namaste.